crossroads. We want to invite you to stand with us and worship. Let's sing together. Here we go. Crossroads, so glad you're here. Take a quick second and say hi to somebody new around you, and then we'll continue to worship.
Thank you. That was awesome. I was rocking down the front row. That was awesome. Thanks, guys. Good morning. Welcome to Crossroads. My name is Hannah Lee, and I'm the Children's Director, and I'm so glad that you've decided to worship with us this morning. I have a few exciting announcements. The first one is that you may have seen the big giant bug out on this parking lot out here. That is the kickoff Trunk or Treat is next weekend, Saturday, October 27th, from 1 to 3:30. You want to be here. You want to bring your friends and your neighbors. We're going to have lots of candy, lots of fun, and in the field out there, we'll be chunking pumpkins across the field and apples. So the fun will be endless. This is a great way for us to invite our friends. We want people to feel welcome at Crossroads, and that's a good introduction to who Crossroads is. So pick up a flyer in the atrium. You can also stop at the table, at the trunk or treat table, and we have lots of ways that you can help. You can host a trunk, just like the one out there, but in order to do that, you need to register your trunk. This is for the safety of our kids, but also because we'll have great prizes for the best trunk. So again, check that out there, and there's other great ways that you can volunteer. The next thing we have is that right now we're in the family series, and so today Dennis Anderson is continuing that with Keys to a Great Family. My husband and I were here last night, and we pulled away with lots of great things. And then next week we'll be doing effective parenting practices. So again, I hope you come next week and learn the great things that we have for you and that God has for you. Lastly, in November, we're going to kick off November with a weekend with Janae Deloach. Janae Deloach is an Olympian. She medaled a bronze medal in 2012 Olympics, and she not only lives in this community, but she goes to Crossroads. So she's going to be here and talk about her Olympic journey and how that parallels with her spiritual journey. So again, this is a great way for you to introduce your friends to Crossroads. You can pick up these cards out in the atrium. It's a great way to invite your friends. And now we're going to continue our time of worship with a time of offering. Offering is a way that we show our support for what God is doing at Crossroads, and it's a way that we worship the Lord. So if you call Crossroads your home, whether you give in the atrium, at the kiosk, in here, or online, financial giving is an awesome way to join in with what God's doing. And if you're a guest, please don't feel obligated to give. So let me lead us in prayer. Dear God, thank you so much for today. Thank you for a band that leads us to the throne of worship, to you, and just with excitement and with passion. And God, it just fills my heart with so much joy to be a part of this team. Lord, I pray that the men and women and the kids here, that they experience you today on their level, wherever they're at. God, that you would teach them great truths that they can take home. And Lord, I pray that you would continue to bless our efforts as we seek to reach our community, that you would be totally the center of that. We love you so much, God, and we praise in your name. Amen.
They say you can't go home again. I just had to come back one last time. Ma'am, I know that you don't know me from Adam, but these handprints on the front steps are mine. And up those stairs in that little back bedroom, it's where I did my homework and I learned to play guitar. And I bet you didn't know that under that live oak, my favorite dog is buried in a yard. I thought if I could touch this place or feel it, this brokenness inside me might start. Just come in, I swear I'll leave. Won't take nothing but a memory from the house that built me. Mama cut out pictures of houses for years, from Better Homes to Garden Magazine. Plans were drawn in concrete, board, and nail by nail, and board by board. Daddy gave life to Mama's dreams. touch this place or feel it. This brokenness inside me might start healing. Now here it's like I'm someone else. I thought that maybe I could find myself. If I could just come in, I swear I'd leave. Won't take nothing but a memory from the house I built. You leave home, you move on, and you do the best you can. I got lost in this whole world and forgot who I am. I thought if I could touch this place or feel it, this brokenness inside me might start healing. Out here it's like I'm someone else. I thought maybe I could find myself. If I could walk around, I swear I'd leave. Won't take nothing but a memory from the house that built me.
Different kinds of families these days, aren't there? Aren't there? Well, I thought I'd kick off with some quick tips on parenting, kind of visual illustrations. And so you could put that first one up there, and this is the first one. You know, why should we as parents have to do all the chores? We should get our kids taught early, don't you think? Don't you think? Not with vacuuming, but when it comes to like household maintenance, we need the kids, teach our kids to paint, right? Right? I mean, they don't always get it right. And then when you're getting them ready for school, sometimes you just can't find that right thing. At least it's not duct tape. I mean, come on. And then when you start teaching your kids how to drive, you know, you got to give them some subtle reminders about speed limits. You could even take these notes, and when your daughter starts to date, well, you can figure out how you might use those. But anyway, and then when you buy diapers, you know, there's a time when it says 7 to 9 pounds. You know, it's not talking about the weight of the diaper. It's talking about the weight of the child. So, well, thought I'd give you some quick parenting tips right off the bat. How many of you have a family? Wow, like everybody, wow. Well, I don't know about your family, but my hunch is that we have this idea of what the ideal family is like, huh? How many of you would go, that's my family? No, because we have this, right? We have the real family. And there's this gap between the real and the ideal. This is kind of what we thought our family would be like, and it's this. When I was in college, I always thought, when I grew up, I would get married to a nurse who'd never been married before. We'd have three kids and live happily ever after on a farm in Wyoming. Well, I married a flight attendant who already had a child. Her first husband was killed in a car wreck. We had a child. We adopted a five-year-old girl from Korea. Then we had another child. And I'm not living happily ever after in Wyoming, as you can see. Happily ever after in Colorado. When it comes to our kids, I like to say we have hers, ours, and theirs. But that's my real family. And I love my real family. And there's a verse in Proverbs 24 that says, by wisdom a house is built, and through understanding it's established. It takes great wisdom to move our real families towards this. And I say towards because we could keep aiming at this. This isn't going to happen in this life. This isn't going to happen. Never has. Oh, wait. One time, I went to the Bible to see if I could find the ideal family, and I found one. Adam and Eve. It's on the first couple of pages of the Bible. Right? They were the ideal people in the ideal environment with the ideal father, and they had the perfect family. For how long? Two pages, right? On page three, things start to move south in a hurry. And maybe I'm a little weird. I actually take great encouragement from page three of the Bible. And here's why, as a parent. God is the perfect parent, had the perfect environment, had the perfect kids, only one rule they had to keep, and they messed up. I'm kind of encouraged by that. I mean, if God can't do it, why should I expect to? We can all take a corporate sigh of relief. Let's just go, wow, because your family's not perfect. Neither is mine. You're not the perfect parent. You don't have perfect kids. In fact, you're just a little messed up. Turn to the person next to you and say, you're just a little messed up. They love for you to say that. And so am I. So am I. Don't you feel better already? Yeah, and I kept reading in the Bible about the kinds of families. And this is what I discovered. Page three, Adam and Eve mess up. Page four, Adam and Eve's son, Cain, is so jealous of his brother that he kills him. We're just four pages in. On page eight, God makes an amazingly loving covenant with Noah. And the very next scene, Noah's drunk in his tent. And when his son sees him, Noah curses him and his family. Page 10, great man of faith, Abraham. Well, he gives his wife to an Egyptian ruler to be the ruler's concubine just to save his skin. Talk about an indecent proposal. That was it. Page 15, Abraham's nephew, Lot, when he's threatened by some men in the city, offers to let his daughters, two daughters, have sex with the men. And later in the story, his two daughters get Lot drunk, they get pregnant, and Lot's the best man in the town. On page 17, Abraham plays favorites with his sons, Isaac and Ishmael. They're estranged. Page 18, Abraham gets his wife's maid pregnant, gets upset with them, sends his wife's maid and their son out into the desert. Page 23, Isaac plays favorites between his sons Jacob and Esau. They're bitter enemies for 20 years. Page 27, Jacob marries two wives who each have a maid. He has children with all four of the women. It's like they're having a baby contest. Page 36, Jacob plays favorites between Joseph and his 11 brothers. The 11 brothers sell Joseph into slavery into Egypt. They go back and tell their father that he's been killed. Happy Father's Day, Dad. Then on page 37, Jacob's son Judah sleeps with his daughter-in-law, who's disguised herself as a prostitute, and she gets pregnant. And I'm only 37 pages into the story. These families, They're messed up. They need a therapist. They need Dr. Phil, Dr. Laura, Dr. Spock, Dr. Ruth, Dr. Seuss. They need somebody. Feel better about your family already? Man. Well, as it says, it takes great wisdom to raise families. Why does the Bible include all this stuff? Well, because the Bible is about reality. Your real family, my real family. And it's about how do we move our families towards the ideal. What can I do as a parent, a grandparent, a brother, a sister, a neighbor, to help move our families and our community towards this? Well, I'm going to give you four keys, four pieces of wisdom today that will help us do that. The first one is this. We need to create a stable home environment. Woman answers the phone one day. There's this young voice on the phone. Mom, can you come over? The baby just threw up. The house is a wreck. I got to pick up the kids from school, and I have no idea what we're going to have for dinner. The lady goes, it's okay, dear. It's okay. I'll be right over. I'll drop by the grocery store. I'll pick up the kids at school. I'll be home. I'll come up to your house. I'll help you get dinner. She says, oh, and by the way, she says, on my way, I'll call Tom and tell him to come home from work early. There's a pause. The young voice goes, Tom? Who's Tom? And the older woman goes, well, it's, you know, my son, your husband. She goes, my husband's name is Alex. I must have dialed the wrong number. Does that mean you're not coming over? Our houses become kind of chaotic from time to time. Proverbs 12:7 says, wicked people fall to pieces, but the homes of good people, wise people, hold together. Alvin Toffler, who wrote Future Shock, said that what people need in times of crisis and chaos is islands of stability. And that's what our homes can be, is an island of stability. It's what a church can be, an island of stability when our families are in times of challenge. Ephesians 6:4 says, fathers, do not exasperate your children. Instead, bring them up in the training and instruction of the Lord. This training and instruction is what creates stability in our families. Having clear expectations, clear boundaries, clear guidelines in families creates stability. When you're driving on the highway, there are guardrails often in many places. When you drive up the Poudre River, there's a place called the Narrows. And when you go through there, it's where the river, where the highway drops, the ditch drops off, and it gets real deep. And in the spring when the river's cranking, you need guardrails there. And there's a place where you drive along the guardrails there, and then there's a place where the guardrail disappears. Whenever I drive by there, I always get a little nervous because there's no guardrail there. And that's what boundaries and expectations could create in families, is that stability, because we need guardrails. Bedtimes, curfews, respectful conversations, sharing household chores, clear consequences when the guardrails, when the guidelines are violated. Those are all a part of helping to create a stable family. And when it comes to boundaries and reinforcing them, there's a spectrum of perspectives, of parenting perspectives, when you think about it. And one of the perspectives is the authoritarian perspective. The authoritarian parent is, I'm in charge. I'm the boss. Children are to be seen and not heard. I rule my family with an iron fist. That's the authoritarian approach. Kids in that kind of structure can grow up passive and you know, uncreative. They can lack initiative. And oftentimes, kids in this system rebel. They do because they haven't learned that they matter that much. And so one day, they want to matter. And even the perspective these children get of God is skewed in this perspective. On the other end of the spectrum is the overly permissive parent. You know, nobody's in charge in this family. Oftentimes, it's driven by a sense of guilt. And I think single-parent families are particularly susceptible to guilt because they have this sense they're competing with another family oftentimes for the welfare and the goodwill of their child. And kids in that system can grow up thinking, well, what I do doesn't really matter. Therefore, who I am doesn't really matter. They could think, hey, I can hurt people and break stuff and somebody else will take care of it. They learn to be takers instead of givers, grow up with a sense of entitlement. And they too can rebel when they grow up because they often believe that they're the center of the world. Again, a skewed perspective of the reality of the world, that God is actually ultimately in charge. And so in the middle of this is a third perspective that's called the authoritative. Perspective, where the parents are firm and fair. That's the authoritative approach. In Proverbs 22:15, it says, "Folly is bound up in the heart of a child, but the rod of discipline will drive it away." This verse says that a child comes into the world believing it's all about me. And for a couple of years, it really is all about them. But as that child gets older, if we don't help them understand, life is not just about you. We're setting that kid up and your family up for a disaster. And the authoritarian person looks at that verse and says, "See, I've got the rod of discipline and I'm going to drive the foolishness out of the heart of my child." And they try to do it with an iron fist. Well, that's to misunderstand really what that verse means. The word for discipline actually means to coach a person, to provide correction and instruction, not demands. That's what coaches do. And the word rod means authority. Doesn't always mean corporal punishment, although it can include that. A coach has inherent authority, but the best coaches try to get the best out of their team as possible. And so if you think of a parent as a coach, as the best coach, and then you think of Proverbs 22:6, which says, "Train up a child in the way he or she should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it." You can apply it in that context because many Bible scholars today now say that the key phrase in this verse is not the training, although that's important, but it's the phrase, "the way the child should go." And what that verse means is that this child has been hardwired with a certain set of gifts and personalities and abilities and a certain spirit. And then empowering that child to become all that God has hardwired that child to become. That's the role of the parent. I talked about empowerment last week. And we need to alter our parenting style given the hardwiring of each child. And that's true whether it's coaching or leading or guiding or even providing correction. Many of us have kids or grandkids where to get them to correct them, all you have to do is give them a look, right? Some of you have kids like that, lucky you. So there's some kids, they require more than that. It's the timeout deal, right? And then they are corrected. Others, I think every family gets one or two of these. It takes even more than that, more aggressive forms of correction. Proverbs 3:12, though, says, "For the Lord corrects those he loves, just as a father corrects a child in whom he delights." Not to correct a child communicates you don't care. Correction communicates that you not only care, but you love that child. And this approach of parenting provides a great deal of flexibility as well as freedom for the child to fail. Children can ask questions. They can think for themselves. They can disagree. They can have feelings. They can express feelings of frustration and anger and sadness and delight as well. And they can learn to express feelings in an appropriate way. That's the authoritative approach. So your child throws a temper tantrum. What do you do? Well, the authoritarian says, "Stop it. You will not be angry." Well, how does that work? Exactly. The permissive parent says, oh, "I'm so sorry. Mommy made you upset, but you can't hit your brother with a baseball bat." The authoritative parent says, "Wow, I can really tell that you're frustrated. I took the bat away from you. You're welcome to scream all you want, but do it in your room. Okay, and when you're finished, then you can come back and join us." Authoritative, fair, firm, that's the way it works. As your kids get older, it gets a little more complicated, but that's the idea. I want to give you some quick tips. I got these out of a book called Parenting Without Pressure. Some bullet points on establishing guidelines and being fair and firm. The first one, define the boundaries before you enforce them. Kids need to know what the expectation is. Second one, let the kids help make some of the rules and the consequences. They'll have more ownership and they'll also communicate, you know what, we have some flexibility as parents. Avoid impossible demands. make sure your child can actually do what it is that you're asking them to do. You know, grounding a kid for the rest of their life probably isn't a healthy boundary. Respond instead of react. You know, nothing is more destructive in a relationship than when the parent, in response to a child, has the meltdown. Yelling, name-calling, other forms of abuse can happen there during a struggle. React instead of, don't react, respond. Distinguish between willful defiance and childhood irresponsibility. Willful defiance is a deliberate act. It says more about the intention of the heart that's going on. And a wise parent has to figure out, is this a childhood irresponsibility or is this a willful act of disobedience? So you're sitting at the table and your four-year-old dumps over a glass of milk. Childhood irresponsibility or willful defiance? Irresponsibility, right? That same child picks up the glass of milk, dumps it in the lap of his sister. You've told him not to do this. Defiance or irresponsibility? Defiance, that's right. So there's a difference. Wise parents learn to determine the difference. Another one, present a united front. You know, and you could be a single parent or a two-parent family where presenting a united front. So when you've established a boundary and the kids crossed it and now it's time for the consequences, what do you do in that moment? Well, kids are masters at negotiation. They want to turn a no into a yes. And if you give in that moment, you don't present a united front, you're setting yourself up for them to do the exact same thing again. Now, if you want to renegotiate the boundary, you can do that, not then though. Because they're just going to learn to negotiate. So present a united boundary. And then the other one, or united front. Say yes as much as you can to kids. I mean, there's so many no's. Say yes. And here's five clarifying questions I found very helpful when a child asks you for something. Is it illegal? Is it immoral? Will it hurt them or somebody else? Number four, will it make a difference in 5 years? And number five, is it appropriate for a child this age? Hey mom, I'm gonna get a tattoo. Five questions. Is it immoral? Is it illegal? No. Will it hurt them or somebody else? No. Question number four, will it make a difference in 5 years? Well, it might. It depends on where it is and what it is. Is it appropriate for a child this age? Your daughter's 12 when she asked for the tattoo. No. 17? Maybe. Again, wisdom to determine. Now, I'm not advocating to get tattoos or not. You know, if you'd like to see mine. I got it when I was 6, but I was... We're more mature in Wyoming. This wants you to... Just some helpful things to creating a stable environment. Clear boundaries, clear consequences, respond instead of react, all those kind of things are real helpful to create a stable environment. That's the first key. Second key, build a strong spiritual foundation. George Barna conducted a survey where he asked parents, who is responsible to create the spiritual foundation in a family? 9 parents out of 10 said it's the parents' responsibility. Then he wrote this. The very people who claim responsibility for the spiritual growth of those children are doing little about it beyond dropping their kids off at church. The majority of parents do not spend any time during a typical week discussing religious matters. Parents typically have no plan for the spiritual development of their children, do not consider it a priority, have little or no training in how to nurture a child's faith, have no related standards or goals that they are seeking to satisfy. Wow, that's kind of hard stuff, isn't it? You know, in the Bible, there was a very influential leader in the life of the early church who benefited from a strong spiritual foundation. And his name was Timothy. 2 Timothy, Paul writes to him, and he says this, I've been reminded of your sincere faith, Timothy, which first lived in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded now lives in you also. Here's a young leader in a church who's facing all kinds of opposition, who because he had that strong, stable, spiritual foundation from his grandmother and his mother, now it sets him up for a life of growth. And it's our responsibility as parents and grandparents to do this in the lives of our children, to grow them spiritually. Every child, every thinking person is going to be asking him or herself these questions as they grow up. And we need to answer them. Like, who am I? How did I get here? Is there a right and a wrong way to act? Is there a God? If there is, what does he expect of me? Is there life after death? How do I get it? Someday, will I be accountable for the way I've lived? What's the meaning of life? Education isn't going to answer those questions. Science isn't going to answer those questions. God is the one who answers all those very meaningful questions, and we as parents can help answer those questions for our children as well. So I'll ask you, how strong is the spiritual foundation of your family? How strong is yours personally? You kind of casual about it? Are you serious? Are you growing? Is it thriving? Are you building on that foundation every week, or are you sort of leaving it up to chance? And how about your kids? How are they doing? Where are they in establishing a spiritual foundation? Now, they may not all build on it. You know, we all know parents, probably Christian parents, who've had kids that have wandered away from their spiritual roots. I have good friends, you know, for whom this is true. My kids did this for a number of years. They have no place for God in their life yet. That happens in some families. So what are we doing on a daily or weekly basis to continue to build that spiritual foundation? And we all know that the kind of input that kids need to have varies as the child grows older. There's a development process. When kids are very young, preschool, they think you are God. That's a little scary, isn't it? Kind of, well, that's cool, but maybe not. But, you know, they think you're God. You're the big person in their life. God's a big person. You're God. As kids begin into grade school, stories and people begin to become more and more important. They can relate to people and stories. That's why Bible stories are so critical at that child's age. As they get into later, into middle school and up into early high school, the thing that begins to develop is they need to take that family kind of orientation and make it personal. Very important time in the life of a middle schooler or high schooler to make God personal in their lives. They can learn to abstract. Now they can understand what it's like to have a relationship with someone you can't see. And as you get into later high school years and early college, things are going to begin to disconnect. They're going to be asking questions that they haven't asked before. Like, how do I know God exists? I've always believed that, but how do I know? How do I know I can trust this Bible? And people in that age range are going to need solid, credible, intellectual basis for their faith, and we need to have those answers. If all we say is, hey, you don't ask questions, you just believe, all we're communicating is that Christianity is just a sophisticated synonym for superstition. We need to have answers for them. And as people growing up to their 20s and 30s, begin to embrace the idea of mystery, ambiguity, paradox. Not going to answer all those big questions. I have to learn with some of the mystery about these things. And that's the spiritual progression of our faith. And sometimes, a lot of times, you think, well, this is time. Spiritual development goes like this. No, doesn't work like that, does it? Sometimes it goes like this. Oh, well, maybe. Oh, yeah. Oh, well, I don't know about that. And then you go on and you take a dip here. And I mean, be honest. Doesn't this look more like you and me? Yeah, and when we're growing like this, oh, these are periods of, these are awesome. Okay, I don't know about what's going to happen here. That was a bummer. And then, oh man, you don't know, where's that going to go? And this is the pathway that we nurture our kids on, because it's the pathway that we took. And what are we doing to nurture this? Well, James 1:5 says, if any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. God has provided generous resources for us who are engaged in this process. And the biggest resource we have is this book, is the Bible. It is. And so the question is, how is it being used in your family? Do you read it? Do you use it? Do you look for it when you're making decisions? Do you expose your kids to it? Do you have child age-appropriate Bibles in your house that you read to them? In that stack of books that you have, all little kids have stacks of books. Are there Bible story books in there? Do you have an age-appropriate Bible and are you reading it? And a second resource that God has for us is this church. We have all sorts of children age-appropriate activities that are going on. And that's why we always encourage parents, hey, put your kids in the kids' area. They're going to hear about the love of God at a level they can understand and appreciate and incorporate into their lives. And here's why this is so important. Because we are exposed to so much input in a given week. Our kids are as well. For instance, media. Our kids have an enormous amount of media that they ingest in a given week. TV, music, computer, etc. Turn to the person next to you and tell them, how many hours a week of media does the average child ingest? Okay, how many hours? Just tell the person next to you how many hours you think it is. Okay, how many of you said 25 hours or less a week? Okay, that's a good guess. How many of you said 30? If you said 53, you'd be right. 53 hours of media, 23 hours of TV watching, 13 hours of music, 8 hours of computer, and 6 hours of video games. That's the average, 53 hours. Now, not all of this is unhealthy or bad. This could be really good. You got 1 hour at church a week of good, solid spiritual input for your child. And that's if you come every week. You know, John gave us a statistic a few weeks ago that said the average family attends church 2 weeks out of every 9. So let's take this up 9 times more. You know, how high would it be? Okay? Oh, you get to double this though, right? 2. That's the average. It's a little spooky, isn't it? So what can we do about this? Well, I have 2 suggestions. The first, leverage this. We're not going to eliminate this. I mean, you could monitor this, and always should, a wise parent should. Leverage this. You know, what kind of music are they listening to? Get some healthy, good input. Good, solid Christian music. Other kinds of music is good as well. And what about the TV shows? There's some great kids' videos and DVDs out there. VeggieTales and Hillsong has some great music videos. You know, just leverage this in the life of your child. And this right here can always go up. You know, if you just go, we're going to be here every weekend. Now you've got 9 hours in that time instead of all of that. And then you can add to this. Middle school and high school have extra events during the week. Now you've got those couple of hours. There's life groups for those kids. You've got those, their couple of hours. For us here, we've got this terrific parenting class going on right now called Love and Logic. You can still get in on that. It's on Wednesday night. You can raise this. Trunk or treat. All of these things can create additional kinds of input streams in the life of our children to build a strong spiritual foundation. And the question in this whole section is, what will the difference be in the long run? I mean, really? One more sport your kid's in? Or it'd be better for them to be in a life group here? What's up to you? You're the parent. You be the judge. But together, as a church and its families, we can build a strong spiritual foundation. That's number 2. Number 3, work at the fun factor. You know, life can get so serious at times, especially in families. The joy and fun can just get squeezed out of our lives. Proverbs 17:22 says, a cheerful heart is good medicine. It just does something for the heart, the fun factor. Proverbs 23, may your father and mother rejoice. May she who gave you birth be joyful. Have some fun. Now, if you spend an hour a day with your child from birth to 18, you'll have 274 days of time with them before they're 18. That's about 9 months of time. That's not much, is it? Now, make sure some of that time is fun. And 2 ideas again. Seize unstructured time. The idea that it's really about quality time and not quantity time just doesn't hold up. A father asked a daughter, would you rather have me for quality time or quantity time? She said, oh, quality time, and a lot of it. And when kids are little, well, if kids are growing up, they're going to ask you for time. And it's not going to be when you have time. You'll be sitting there doing something. Hey, Dad, let's play. hey, mom, can we read a book? And the temptation is going to be, I don't have time. Not now, later. Well, there might not be a later. Seize unstructured time. The other night, our grandkids were over, and it was time for them to go home, and they live like 5 blocks from us. And so Lila, who's two, we were taking her to the front door, and I just made up this little song, oh, it's time to go home, and Papa was so glad you were here. We danced around, and I threw her in the air, and when I caught her, she looked me in the eye, and she said, one more time, Papa. So we went out on the driveway, and I did the little dance, and threw up in the air, and sang the song, goofy little song that I just made up, and she looked me in the eye, and she said, one more time, Papa. So we went down the block, and we did it again. Then we went down to another block, and we kept doing it all the way home, and I'm getting, like, out of breath. I'll never forget, we were, like, 3/4 of the way to her house. Middle of the street, dark out, right under a street light. My granddaughter and I are dancing in the middle of the street. It's Fort Collins, there's no cars. And we just dance, and I'm singing, and I throw her up in the air, and I catch her, and she looks me in the eye, and she says, one more time, Papa. And I did it all the way to her house. One more time. I'll never forget that moment. And you never know when your child or grandchild comes to you and says, let's play. There might not be a one more time someday. Seize unstructured time and just give it to them. Just give it to them. And the second thing then is to plan extended time together, of fun. And as your kids get older, you're going to have to involve them in this process more because it's going to get more and more complicated. And for the last 6 years, our family has taken a family vacation in the summer. We've carved it out. We have to get on the calendar early. Right now in our family, we have 8 jobs we have to coordinate, 8 of us, schedules and whatnot. And our idea of a family time together is 4 non-travel days. So 2 days of travel on either end, and we're together for 4 interrupted days. That's our idea. And every year, we do try to do something different. And our family, you know, this last summer, every family in our family got to plan a day of activities. And it was a great time. We stayed here in Colorado. If you'll indulge me, I actually have a couple pictures. Family vacation pictures from the Andersons. This is our hike up on Independence Pass, all of us. And we just had a terrific time. And then we go biking together. So this is a picture of a previous summer when we were all biking together. And notice there's a baby in that picture. We don't allow babies to, we actually teach them to bike really young. This was last summer. We're taking on the Arkansas River. Notice my wife there out on the front, my 2 boys paddling her up this spot. Didn't quite end up that way. This is what the next scene. Notice where my wife's foot is. She got it stuck in that boat there, and the boat flipped, and she sprained her ankle, and we had to carry her out of the river and up to the car. Great memory. These things happen, right? It was fun. It was fun. Next summer, we're thinking about Moab. We're going to venture out a little further. We're already starting to put it on the calendar. But these times, these structured times of extended fun don't just happen. You got to get your calendar. You got to plan them. Plan those fun times together. And I know it might not always be possible, but we're going to cling on to this and cultivate it as long as we can. That's 3. And 4, love your children like God loves us. Josh McDowell said, rules without relationship is automatic rebellion. And God doesn't have rules for us just because he's into rules. God's not like the ogreish father who leans over the balcony of heaven looking for somebody having fun and going, cut that out. No, in Jeremiah 31:3, God says, I've loved you, my people, with an everlasting love, with unfailing love, I have drawn you to myself. God enjoys human connection. He loves us. And to enjoy that, it takes a lot of loving. It takes a lot of disciplining on God's part, guiding, pursuing, giving, nurturing, respecting, knowing, and forgiving. And Jesus demonstrated every one of those characteristics as well. That's why we have families, is so that this can happen. And it's not easy, is it? Being a parent, you know, the moment that child is conceived, as much fun as that moment was, we take on a great responsibility for the shaping of a life that's going to last on into eternity forever and ever. We take that on. I'm going to put on my pastor and my parent hat for just a minute, and I want to say to all the parents and all the grandparents in this room, be the parent. Lead your family. Don't be the kid. I mean, you can act like a kid once in a while, but don't be the kid in your family. Be the parent. Lead your family. And I know this isn't always easy. It's sometimes a bit of a muddle, as I talked about last week. But be the family. And if you're here, you know, listening, and you're a young person, a teenager, you can do a lot to help create a great family. And you just need to know that for the vast majority of parents, they love you. They would give, your parents would give their life for you. They're doing everything they know to help you become the best human being you can become. They're doing that. You may not like their rules. You may disagree with them. You may not disagree with their parenting style. They don't have it perfect, neither do you. You may not believe in their God or their convictions, but you have to know your parents love you. They just do. And they're doing the best they can by you. And you can do a lot to help create a great family. But when it comes to families, you know, I read this story this week. I go, that's the way it's been for my family. I often feel like a rookie. Like I have so much to learn no matter how old my kids are. I feel like a rookie. There was a time when a rookie got to play basketball with Michael Jordan when the Chicago Bulls were at their peak. And it was a night when Michael Jordan scored 66 points and the rookie scored 2. And an interviewer, a reporter, was asking the rookie afterwards, what was it like to play with Michael Jordan? And the rookie responded, well, tonight, Michael and I scored 68 points. When it comes to family, we often feel like the rookie, but you know what? We have God. We do. And God is like Michael Jordan, and he will score points when you wonder how he can do it. And so no matter where your family is, and some of you might be experiencing great heartache in your family now. Last week I talked about a lot of the deep water I'd been through with my family. But here's three things we never did. Barbara and I never gave up on each other. We didn't always agree, but we never gave up on each other. We never gave up on our kids, and we never gave up on God. I want us to stand and finish the service, and we're going to read a verse out of Galatians together. It's Galatians 6, 9. It's up on the screen. And I think this is the mantra of every parent, or needs to be. So let's read this out loud together. Let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time, we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. Let's read it again, a little more confidence. Let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time, we will reap a harvest if we do not give up.
Against me, but I will hold my ground.
You ready to take on this raising of the next generation? Let's pray and ask God's help. God, we need your help to do this. You've given us a great responsibility, and it's a great privilege. And we want to see the families in our community take a step forward this week. Take a step away from selfishness and unforgiveness. Take a step toward each other. And God, it's not just going to impact this generation, but it's going to ripple into the next and into the next. And God, we need your help. We do. We can't do it on our own. We need each other, and we need you. Thank you that you never give up on us. You'll never leave us. So God, will you do it? And everybody who agreed with this said, amen. Amen. Thanks for being here. Next week, two things before you leave. Next week, John Smith's going to be here. He's going to finish the series, so don't miss that. And on your way out, we have this photo booth up on the landing. So grab your family, grab some friends, go up there and take a cool picture. See you next weekend.